And good morning, good afternoon, good evening, and wherever you happen to, or whenever you happen to be listening to this lecture. Welcome to AJS 230, the police function. And we're going to be looking at patrol operations. Now, patrol operations is certainly the most visible part of policing, and certainly the part of policing that requires the most manpower, if not requiring, at least getting the most manpower. Sir Robert Peel has often said that patrol is the backbone of policing. So what does that mean? Well, I think in Peel's view, it means that patrolling is probably the one thing that is common in every police department. Somebody's going out there and performing some kind of patrol, and everything the patrol discovers, everything that is discovered by other units, eventually starts or ends in patrol. So with that said, we're going to take a look at how patrol is done in various places around the country, and we're going to have a look at some of the problems that are often associated with patrol. Now, let's take a look at this particular example. Now, if you'll notice in this particular photograph, aside from the fact that they printed it backwards, presumably to hide the name of the police department. Of course, we could go on at great length as to why our publishers want to hide the police department. Maybe they didn't have permission. Maybe this exceeds someone's licensing. But it's like I said, there's a lot of whys and what ifs. But what do we have? We have two police officers dressed in what appears to be military-style fatigues and what looks like level 4 armor, which is probably designed to stop rifle fire, and they're out walking a dog. Well, I wouldn't exactly call it walking a dog, but what does it look like they're doing? Why are they dressed like that? Is this your typical officer on the street? Probably not. This is probably part of a SWAT deployment. More than likely, the officer or these two officers here are probably tracking some form of high-risk suspect. Now, if you'll also notice, if you look in the background of this photograph, you have a number of people that are crowded and watching what's going on. But it looks like they're being held back with barrier tape. So it could very well be that these officers are not routine patrol officers, are not performing some kind of regular patrol, but instead they're on some kind of high-risk watch, perhaps even looking for bombs or improvised explosive devices. The bottom line is, these guys wouldn't be called out unless patrol got there first. Patrol is required to seek out and respond to situations of unknown danger. And they, once they arrive, they have to make a decision as to whether or not additional equipment and resources are needed. So, just as a brief introduction, we're going to talk about police patrol operations, what they do, how it's done. We're also going to look at the various academic studies of the 60s and 70s. It's these academic studies of the 60s and 70s that form the basis of many patrol-level decisions that go on today. Now, most of this chapter will be related to police patrol operations, which it should. But it's also going to discuss traffic and special operations. The reason being is that in most agencies, and especially the agencies I worked for, because SWAT was not a full-time operation. SWAT comprised of people who were out on patrol, or they're working the detective bureau, but most of the time it was patrol officers. When there was a situation that required SWAT, then these officers would be diverted from patrol and respond to a SWAT operation. So with that said, let's get started. Let's look at, for example, the traditional methods of police work involve what our authors like to call three cornerstones of traditional police work. In other words, most police work forms around these three things. Number one is random routine patrol. And the idea behind random routine patrol is that officers are assigned to a given geographic area. They, on a random basis, drive around and either look for things, or the second cornerstone of police work, they respond to a citizen's request for service. Okay, and as I was talking about before that call came in, not exactly a 911 call. The second cornerstone of traditional police work is responding to calls for service. Now, this slide says rapid response to citizens' calls to 911. Not every call that is phoned in a 911 is an emergency. More often than not, it's usually somebody who has a question about some kind of city-related policy or procedure. And so this is why many cities have adopted the 211 system. The idea is that if people want information about various infrastructure or government-related services, they can call 211 and save the incoming 911 lines for those who truly require emergency service. We'll see how well that works. The third cornerstone of, as our authors like to call it, is the retroactive investigation of past crime. This is probably one of the biggest draws, and I'm not saying it derogatorily, but much of the time, especially if you're working later day shift or afternoon shift and early night shift, most of the time, police patrol is involved in investigating crimes that have occurred in the past. What happens is roughly about 80% of the population is up and working between the hours of, say, 7 a.m. and 6 p.m. And so what happens is people come home from work, they find the front door kicked in. And so they call the police and request that they investigate these burglaries, home invasions, destruction of property, fraud, theft, embezzlement, and a whole host of crimes. So this is the other reason why Peel said that patrol is the backbone of policing, because patrol is the first one that receives any information about any crime that's occurred in that particular jurisdiction. So these will always be the traditional employment of patrol. Why? Because the public expects it. If the public doesn't see a patrol car in their particular area, they tend to get rather upset, and they tend to express this emotion by voting people out of political office. And so these three cornerstones are probably not going to go anywhere for a very long time. So with that said, what does a typical patrol officer do? Now, our authors say that a patrol officer is typically involved in foot patrol. In my experience, that hasn't happened much. Foot patrol is engaged when there's enough people to do foot patrol. There, as we've talked about before, at least half of the police departments in the United States have approximately 12 or so full-time equivalent police officers. And as we calculated, that's roughly enough to put one officer on every 8-hour shift, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, leaving perhaps a police chief left over to supervise the department. So under those circumstances, is it a good idea to remove someone or to remove somebody from a car and do foot patrol? Probably not. So keep this in mind as you're doing your reading this week. Crime deterrence and a feeling of public security, they kind of go hand in hand. We're going to talk about deterrence of crime when we talk about the Kansas City project. So I'm not going to spoil that just yet. Feeling of public security, again, this is something that people tend to expect. If they live in a built-up area, they're going to want to see a patrol officer or a patrol car driving down the street because it makes them feel secure. It makes them think that if something bad were to happen to me, the police are going to show up in a reasonable period of time. 24-hour availability, again, we talked about this before. Average department consists of approximately 12 or fewer full-time equivalent officers. And the or fewer means that there's a lot of departments that don't have 24-hour availability. Fortunately, in Cochise County, every municipal police department and the sheriff's office has 24-hour availability. But notice I said municipal and county sheriff. So that means somebody is not on 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. It's a relatively undiscussed secret. And I wouldn't even call it a secret because it's really a matter of public record. But the Arizona Department of Public Safety, our state troopers, are not available 24 hours a day. In southeast Arizona, Cochise County in particular, DPS is not on the road after 2 a.m. Once the bars close, they're done. There's currently a number of bills in the state legislature that will make or will hire enough troopers to have 24-hour availability. But we're not there yet. And this also talks about, or also speaks to, the availability of reserve officers. Now, one of the things that DPS has told me is that they are so busy trying to fill positions that get a paycheck, trying to fill paid officer positions, they don't have time to even deal with reserve officers at this moment, which is unfortunate, because the reserves are going to save them a whole lot of money. And if we had enough reserve troopers, would we have 24-hour availability? Oh, probably. With that said, there are other departments that are not on 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Many of them are in Arizona. In most residential areas, they are covered with a 24-hour service. But I've known many departments, not just in Arizona, but also in Michigan, whose police officers were not available between the hours of 12 p.m. and 7 a.m. or were not available between the hours of 2 a.m. to 7 a.m. Once again, keep in mind, average department, 12 or less. And it's the or less that does not have that 24-hour availability. Next up, we're going to talk a little bit about one of the pioneers of policing, certainly one of the grand old men. I hate to use the term, but this person was truly a pioneer. He was truly a visionary when it came to policing, and that is O.W. Wilson. We're going to talk a little bit about O.W. Wilson in just a few moments. And we're back. We're going to talk a little bit about O.W. Wilson, or Orlando. His real first name was Rolando Wilson. Orlando Wilson was responsible for a number of practices and procedures that continue to be used this very day. Now, to take a look at his biography, O.W. Wilson was probably one of the first educated police officers in history. Wilson, after he graduated high school, was admitted to the University of California, Berkeley, where another pioneer, August Vollmer, had significant impact and influence over the criminology school at Berkeley. And Wilson was a student there at the time, and also while he was a student, he was also a member of a police officer at the Berkeley Police Department. Oddly enough, Vollmer also had some supervisory experience as well. He was also a former police chief at a number of organizations, starting out, of course, in the California area, and then he became, at 28 years old, relatively unheard of, unless you're in a very small department, he became the chief of police in what was one of America's major cities at the time, and that was Wichita, Kansas. Wichita at the time was still very much a cattle town, still very much cowboy influenced. It made its living on the stockyards and meatpacking and so forth. And Wilson instituted a number of reforms at the Wichita Police Department. A lot of them included the hiring and promoting of visible minorities. He also introduced radio communication. It was very big on radio-equipped patrol officers. Wilson believed that a radio-equipped patrol officer not only worked more efficiently, but also was easier to manage and supervise. Kind of makes sense. Because you could have a desk sergeant sitting or a patrol sergeant sitting out at a precinct house or at a headquarters, and he can call and check on the status of his people anytime he wanted. Now, prior to that, what was the technology at the time? The technology at the time involved having a police officer call a station at predetermined intervals. In other words, he had to go somewhere, find a call box, unlock the call box, take out a phone, and call the police. With that said, call box operations are still in existence in many cities today, even in some of the most technologically advanced cities in the country. San Jose comes to mind. In fact, somewhere in my files, I even have a listing of call boxes in San Jose. But that's another story for another day. Wilson believed that police patrol is most effective when they create a sense of omnipresence. In other words, where they give the impression that there's always a police officer everywhere there is. And if you look at criminology, if someone believes there, again, it comes right back to rational choice and routine activities theory, if there are capable guardians or if a criminal perceives that he's going to get caught, and caught readily, then he's not as likely to do crime. Kind of makes you wonder if maybe Wilson was using some of Vollmer's teachings at Berkeley to form his decisions. But hey, take AJS 225 and find out for yourself, right? All right, so Wilson also assigned patrol officers based upon primarily two things. One is workload, and the type of work to be performed. So let's say, generally speaking, in most departments, the greatest call volume occurs during the afternoon shift, usually from the hours of 3 p.m. to 11 p.m. And so what Wilson did was, instead of having equal numbers of patrol officers around the clock, he would have most of his patrol officers on afternoon shift. The night shift would have the fewest officers, And the day shift would have more than the night shift, but generally speaking, less than afternoons, because the call volume, the workload, wasn't there. He also made assignments based upon the type of work to be performed. This is where we started to see officers become more specialized, where if you had patrol officers who were particularly good at something like investigation, or particularly good at some other job function, that's where they would be assigned. So we started to see more patrol officers having secondary specialties. Nowadays, we have patrol officers that have secondary specialties in training, traffic enforcement and investigation, criminal investigation, forensic investigation, and so forth. And those have become their secondary assignments. And so we can thank Wilson for having the presence of mind and the education to do that, rather than simply making everybody the same and having them do the same job. Unfortunately, that memo hasn't exactly circulated to all departments. But that's why you're here, to find out about these ideas. And perhaps when you find yourself as a first-line supervisor, you'll put those ideas into use. Speaking of ideas into use, how would we know if these ideas work? The reality is you don't. The reality is that evaluating the effectiveness of police work is difficult at best, because we don't know how many crimes we've prevented based upon what we've done. It tends to be very difficult to measure. You can certainly look at the police, at the crimes that were reported, but if you remember from HAS 101 and HAS 225, there's that little thing called the dark figure of crime. We don't know about the crimes that were never reported. And as you probably have noticed, there's a lot of crimes that are not reported. That's why it's difficult to measure how effective policing is. You could also look at another variable, how many people complain about the police. You can look at survey findings. Are people happy with police? Again, if they were stopped for a traffic infraction the day before, do you think they're going to be happy? Probably not. So oftentimes it's difficult to determine whether or not what you've done is particularly effective. So when you have a situation where your jurisdiction has a sudden upsurge in crime, people are going to come to the police and they're going to say, how can I deal with this? And even in the smallest department, you may find yourself in the situation where your chief, your sheriff, your watch commander has either a shift meeting or comes to officers individually and says, we have a problem about this, that, and the other thing. What should we do? What's your response going to be? No. I can't think of a better way to find yourself on the midnight shift permanently. An officer who continually responds to questions such as that with the response of no, is probably not going to go very far and is not going to be considered much of a value. So eventually that officer is going to get passed over. He's going to find himself, like I said, permanently on the night shift. He's going to be doing secondary assignments that he's not going to like. The officer that is of value will be able to critically think about a situation and come up with creative methods to address it. And even if you're in patrol by yourself and you have to deal with a situation, you're still required to critically think about what's going to happen, what can I do, what are going to be the unintended consequences. You have to be creative. And when it comes to these issues, creativity is going to come up with some method to get this done. You can't just simply regurgitate an answer out of a book and hope for the best. It's not going to work. So this is one of the things that when you are in college, you have to learn how to creatively think. With that said, much of the things that we see were the result of somebody's creative thinking at one point or another. And so those ideas later became doctrine that's used by other departments. So it doesn't hurt to see what other departments are doing, and one should always develop their sense of creative thinking. Don't count on an answer that you memorized the night before, because the question is not going to happen. So learn how to think. With that, we're going to talk briefly about one of the most, if not the most, influential study of policing to date, and that is the Kansas City study. This study occurred in the late 60s, early 70s during the Nixon administration, when we had an organization called the LEAA, Law Enforcement Assistance Administration. This government agency allocated funds for college education of police officers, better training, better research, to hopefully come up with better ideas as to how to improve policing. One of those was the Kansas City study. And what it did was it divided the entire city of Kansas City into various sectors. And Sector 1 was an area that was, that if you were in science class, would say it would be the control area. This is the area that was not changed whatsoever. Sector 2 received no patrol at all. Police officers were simply parked in an area and dispatched from call to call. Another area received patrol, but it was in, if I remember the experiment correctly, it was in unmarked vehicles. And as I mentioned, there was another area that was the control area. And so this went on for a year. And at the end of that year, the experiment was written up and the data was averaged. And as a result, the researchers found that adding patrols, removing patrols, or leaving them the same didn't make any difference whatsoever in the crime rate. So what does that say of random patrol? Statistically, it doesn't work. Scientifically, it doesn't work. And it makes sense. Because if you're in a police car that's marked, all they're going to do is wait for the police to go by. And then they're going to perpetrate. So therefore, of those three cornerstones, random patrol, responding to calls, and retrospective investigation, random patrol doesn't work. Random patrol has no effect on crime whatsoever. So what are we going to do with random patrol? Well, unfortunately, it's going to be around for a long time, because even though we've proven it doesn't work, the citizenry expects it. They expect police officers to continue to go on random patrol. If they don't see that police car, the citizens are not going to be happy. Coming up next, we're going to look at some other academic studies of patrol, and we're going to see what science tells us about patrol. So we talked about the Kansas City study, and there's a lot of people that criticize it. A lot of people say that, or rather a number of scholars say that it wasn't it was not a rigorous study. It didn't follow all the rules and procedures of creating a good study. With that said, the one thing you can say about the Kansas City study is that it was the predecessor to many other studies that have occurred since then and continue to occur today. What these studies have basically found out is that patrol activity has four functions, and they are on the slide you see. Notice how it says, it doesn't say respond to emergency calls. Calls for service, emergent or not, will remain for as long as we are here, or for as long as policing will continue. So that's not going to change a lot. Preventative patrol, certainly, but as we found out in AJS 101, very seldom do police show up at a crime in progress. Often enough, they show after it's occurred, but not while it's in progress. Officer-initiated activities is another basic function of law enforcement, and many of those officer-initiated activities include inspecting buildings and businesses, especially licensed premises or alcohol-serving premises. Another one is traffic. Many officers do engage in traffic enforcement when they're not answering calls for service or they're not on a patrol. And it's not a bad thing. It's not because the city's hungry for revenue, but rather traffic enforcement discovers other crimes in progress. It discovers people that are wanted. It discovers people trafficking drugs and contraband. It keeps guns off the street. So there's always a place for traffic enforcement, regardless of what some ill-informed person may be saying. And, of course, administrative tasks. There's always those administrative tasks that have to be done. Let me give you an example of one such administrative task. At the department I used to work for, in fact, the last department I worked for before I retired from policing, one of those administrative tasks that we were expected to do was to deliver what was called the council mail. And that meant that briefing packages and information packages that were intended for the council members just before the council meeting had to be delivered to each council member. And so who delivered them? Typically the afternoon shift police officer. And so this is all based upon various patrol activity studies that were devised by a scholar, probably paid for by the Justice Department or even not, because a number of departments track officer activity. And so it's not difficult for someone who wants to see this activity come up with their own activity study and perhaps publish it in a journal, which is where actually a lot of this research comes from. Most university professors are required to publish because this particular college is not a university. Our faculty is not obliged in any way, shape, or form to conduct research, although I do. And so what a lot of professors do at these institutions is they will contact government agencies, the police, and obtain their statistical data for a given 6-month or 1-year period. And they will conduct a study based upon statistical analysis of that data. Now, with that said, other department or agency administrators, if they're smart, will also conduct their own statistical analysis. And they will find out what their officers are doing and when they're doing it. And as a result, when city council decides they want to cut the budget, which they typically do, because in most communities, law enforcement typically is one of the, I would say, top 5 budget items. That way, the city council is aware of what the police are doing. So one of the things that happened roughly around the time of post-World War II up until about the 1970s is we started to see a movement from officers that were walking the beat to officers that were assigned to a patrol car. Now, for example, in Detroit, this happened roughly in the 1950s. And you can see in some of the Detroit police historical footage how you had some officers walking a beat and some officers in cars. So you started to see a transition. The transition became complete in the mid to late 60s. Why? One of the things that we found out, again, through research, is that police officers in cars tend to be more efficient. They can cover more ground at less cost than putting somebody on a foot beat. And it makes sense. If you have an area that requires roughly between 4 and 10 officers on foot patrol, and you can cover the same area with one officer or two officers in a patrol car, if you were a chief of police, which way would you go? And so we started to see a trend, again, thanks to Orlando Wilson, of officers patrolling in one-man units. The idea, of course, is that the big patrol car painted black and white or some other conspicuous color scheme creates a sense of omnipresence. It comes, however, at a cost. The cost is that the officers no longer have contact with citizens, and the officers become rather isolated because it's very difficult to hold a conversation with a police officer while he's in a patrol car with the windows rolled up, traveling at 25 miles an hour. Kind of snarky, yeah, I get it, but that's the problem. You no longer have that relationship. And so if you don't have the relationship, what happens to police community relations? So again, as we talked about, we started to see some discussion. As I mentioned before, O.W. Wilson, through a number of his studies, showed that one officer patrol cars were far more efficient. Unfortunately, it also comes at a cost. In a larger city, if you're going to calls that end up being a high hazard call, where's your backup? Your backup is typically not there. You have to wait for another officer from another sector to come in and assist you. And so that tends to create a certain officer safety issue. Now, the Los Angeles Sheriff's Department solved that problem. Officially on the books, the Los Angeles County Sheriff fields in exclusively one-man patrol cars. But what they did is they staffed that second officer in a sheriff's car with a reserve deputy sheriff. Same amount of training, same level of authority, but no paycheck. There's a thought. Now, again, as I mentioned, when you put officers in cars, they tend to lose contact with the community because there isn't that relationship that develops between the officer and his area. And so you started to see a return to foot patrol. One of the studies that was done on foot patrol, it wasn't necessarily a community policing study, was in Newark, New Jersey. And in Newark, the researchers found that people tend to be more satisfied with police service when they're on a foot patrol as opposed to being in a car. Now, this probably was a result, of course, after the Newark riots that occurred in the mid to late 60s, which involved police action. And so what this involves is that officers were now going out on foot patrol. People liked it. People had that relationship. And they started to see that officer as somebody more than just somebody who shows up and does bad things. This study, of course, was followed up by another study that was done on community policing that it occurred in Flint, Michigan. Michigan State University did that study. In fact, it was Robert Chojanowicz who did that research, published that research, and coincidentally, I end up working with his son, Eric, at a sheriff's department. We were both deputy sheriffs. Of course, he's since gone on to bigger and better things. But having said that, people are generally more satisfied because, as Trojanowicz found out, people like to have that relationship with that beat officer. It makes them feel better. It makes them feel safer. And in some circumstances, that may be all you need to justify policing. Although, I dare you to go to Flint right now and try to find a officer walking a beat. It just simply isn't done because Flint just doesn't have the money. So eventually, all of this research led to something that is known as evidence-based policing. And evidence-based policing began to displace the old traditional methodology where a bunch of upper management who said, well, this is how we did it 50 years ago. We're going to continue to do it the same way. And so the problem with doing it in that fashion is time changes. Things change. Technology changes. And so you can't afford to continue to do it the same way. So what do? You let go of the traditional wisdom. You let go of the idea of, well, if it's been done for 50 years, chances are it needs to be changed. Or 20 years. Or 15 years. So what do? If you're smart, you apply best practices from literature. Now, this is where a college-educated police officer can be a real asset to their department. Because if you've gone to college, you know how to do a literature search. Not a Google search, but a literature search. This is where you learn how to use Google Scholar, use keywords, and you look up the scientific literature. It requires officers to be research literate. And this is as I mentioned before, and I'm going to mention it again, this is why college-educated police officers can be important, even in the smallest departments. Chances are, in the smallest departments, your chief didn't go to college. I can think of at least half the departments in this county where the chief executive has not attended college, much less staff and command school. And so you go to the literature, you find out what people have been doing research on, and you take those best practices that have come out of experimentation in the literature and you apply it to your own department. You monitor and evaluate the projects to make sure that they're indeed going the way they're supposed to, that they're indeed providing a benefit. And then you share that information with other departments. And this is where things such as, again, the college-educated officer has an advantage. But even then, you might need some help. And this is where it's a good idea for departments to have partnerships with colleges and universities. And this is probably one of the benefits that we have at Cochise College, because I currently have a partnership with one of the largest police departments in the county, where we are doing research, we're evaluating body-worn video, and we're going to find out what are the best practices, and what are practices that should be abandoned. And eventually it's going to be written up, it's going to end up in a scientific journal, where it can be shared with other departments. And the folks that know all about that stuff, what do we call them? Professor. One of the things we can, again, look at is the use of
scientific evidence and how it relates to policing. As we talked about in the previous slide, evidence-based policing leads to the best practices. In other words, how do we get the most bang for our buck? How do we efficiently spend money and spend it so that we're actually doing something? One of those is predictive policing. And predictive policing came out of a number of studies, some of which are currently in progress, where researchers have found if you put certain businesses together, there's going to be a higher amount of drug-related crime and drug-related violence that happens. And so the idea is we use data. We use data-driven policing to predict crime, predict where the offenders are, who the offenders are going to be, and predicting victims of crime. And if we look at data, if we, to use a term, moneyball crime, which we've already seen in a previous TED Talk, we can predict with a certain amount of accuracy where the next crime is going to be. And one of those is, of course, smart policing. This smart policing came out of evidence-based policing, and it's starting to, this particular pattern or process is starting to become very popular in a number of cities, both large and small. And so what this involves is having problem-solving teams operate in a given area. These are people that get to know their people, they get to know their city, or they get to know their district, because it's not just a city. This can be done even in the out county as well, where these problem-solving teams use hard data, and they determine who the offenders are and where they're going to offend. One of the things we found out in these various studies regarding hotspots and crime is that roughly 90% of the calls for service occur in the same 10% or less of locations in a given district. And they're perpetrated usually by the same 10% of offenders. And so if you focus your resources on these offenders, you are bound to create a significant reduction in crime. By the way, these various evidence-based policing initiatives, they also found out something else that was interesting too. Again, this is something for your, that's discussed in a certain amount of detail in your AJS 225 class. What you're finding out is that most offenders generally live within a 1 mile radius of where they offend. Why? They know their area. And so when you engage in smart policing, you go after those particular offenders. Again, this leads to some very well-informed decisions regarding personnel deployment, and it's certainly better than random patrol where you simply drive around an area and go look for things. Instead, you direct your patrol officers to where the problems are. And this is certainly an alternative to random routine patrol, certainly better than engaging in let's drive around and hope for the best, but instead you direct your efforts in the areas that need it the most, that have the greatest problem. And you do it at a time where the offenders are most likely to be out. Again, this is where looking at your own data can provide a wealth of information as to where to direct your forces. And it tends to be cost effective. It doesn't make a lot of sense to put 4 officers on each shift when most of your problem children are operating between the hours of 7 p.m. and 3 a.m. This is what we found out in my first suburban city that I worked in, is that most problems occur between the hours of 7 p.m. and 3 a.m. So we had, instead of having equal deployment across all shifts, We had smaller deployments on days and nights, but we put on a power car between the hours of 7 at night and 3 in the morning, and that dealt with a lot of our problem children. So that brings us to differential response to calls for service. In other words, is it necessary to send a police car to every single call for service? Is it necessary? Is it a waste of resources? So what can we do? We can either refer this to another agency, or we can start using non-sworn people. And an example of that, of course, is in Glendale. Glendale uses community service officers, as does Tucson. And those particular non-sworn officers get paid less money, but are generally involved in less dangerous assignments. And so, therefore, it makes more financial sense to send a community service officer rather than a fully sworn, fully paid police officer to handle something that they don't need to do. Let's see how that works.
In 2015, the city hired a company called CityGate Associates to come in and evaluate the city's practices and manpower for the officers and ways to free up officers. Did you look at this report? In that study, they determined that it's going to be the best served if we could hire 6 more community service officers. Those community service officers would take minor crash reports, then crime scene investigation, we're going to take photographs, fingerprints, where we lift fingerprints, collect DNA, things that would assist patrol and freeing up officers that didn't necessarily need an officer to respond to.
Well, I started as a Glendale Police Explorer almost 5 years ago. I started when I was 15 years old. Once I turned 21, I applied for the lobby position at the Glendale Police Department, and I was doing that for 6 months, and then I got hired here. A normal day for me would probably, I'd come in and then I'd log into my tablet. If there's any accidents, I'll go to them. Depending if there's not, I'll probably catch up on paperwork that I had from the night before. It's always a different day. It's never the same. I like interacting with people. It's kind of, I guess, the accident portions, having to, you know, help people, because we've all been in accidents. Sometimes you don't know what to do, and so I feel helping the public and just going out there, being able to answer their questions, because a lot of them are like, I've never been in an accident, I don't know what to do, am I doing the right thing? So just answering their questions. Yeah, we go out individually, but every now and then, like, we'll always go to the same calls to help each other out, just to see, you know, do you need help?
I've always been one to like to work outdoors in the field, having an office outside, to me is a perfect job for me. And coming to work every day, I always have that feeling, I can't wait to see what's going to happen. Having a job where you wake up and want to go to work is terrific, and I'm loving it. And community members and officers alike are very happy that we're able to get out there and get on those and get the scenes cleared up, make the scenes safe so other motorists aren't involved in accidents that are related to other cars blocking the roadway. So, great feedback, both sides. The public loves it, the officers love it. It's a win-win situation.
Now, one of the other things that you should keep in mind when you complete your studies here is that you're gonna want to find a job somewhere. One of the things that you can do is you can apply at a department that uses civilian community service officers. And the advantage of doing that is you're a benefited paid employee of that department. If there are openings in as a police officer, it would be easier for an administrator to promote or reassign somebody from community service officer to police officer trainee and then eventually to police officer. Because all they have to do in most circumstances is to simply click on their mouse, change the status, and they're done. They save a lot of money when it comes to the background investigation. They already know who they have. They know what they want. They have an established track record of the department, and it tends to be a backdoor way or a way to get your foot in the door when times can be tough. Now, with that said, let's look at another method of dealing with public complaints, or rather dealing with citizen concerns, and that is reverse 911 and smart 911. Both of these do the same thing, and that is they get information to people. So what if you're a police officer and you're working a traffic accident? Wouldn't it be nice to tell people that a particular road is closed just so they don't come into your accident scene, so they don't create bigger problems? Or maybe get some people to actually watch what goes on. Let's see how that works.
And first 3 out of 10, calling 911 in reverse.
After a string of break-ins in Clark County, police are now calling you. Mattel Levy is working for you with how the technology works and why the sheriff is calling it a success. Thousands of residents in Clark County received a call from the sheriff this week. It's all part of an effort to find whoever is responsible for burglaries in the area.
In the last few days, we've had several daytime burglaries committed across Clark County.
That's the voice of Clark County Sheriff Gene Kelly, warning 26,000 residents about 10 daytime burglaries.
What we believe happens is that these people come to the residence, they look in the windows, they feel that it's pretty much unoccupied, and then they knock on the door, no one answers, they go around to the back, they kick in the door.
Once inside, they grab jewelry, electronics, even guns, and stash the goods in sheets. Howard Baker, who's lived in Springfield his whole life, says these crimes hit close to home.
My first reaction was, basically, I was just like I said, I was in shock. I just, like, wow.
Baker says he's been the victim of a home burglary, so he knows exactly what it's like for his next-door neighbor.
I mean, I know how the neighbors are feeling because I've had it happen. It's an empty feeling. They come to your house and you have nothing.
But thanks to the reverse 911 call.
This is Clark County Sheriff Gene Kelly asking for your help.
More people are aware to keep their eyes open for anything suspicious. And the sheriff says it's working.
This morning we got 13 calls from citizens. We don't care. The only call that you should be ashamed that you make is the one that you don't make. We want you to call.
So do residents, like Baker.
It's Christmas time and people, you know, got a lot to worry about financially. More than, you know, now they got to worry about replacing stuff they lost and stuff like that. That's just not cool.
As for the motive for the crime, Sheriff Kelly tells me he believes the suspects are using the stolen items to pay for drugs. And despite those tips from neighbors, no arrests have been made. So if you see anything suspicious, call police. Mattel Levy, 2 News, working for you.
So, as they say before, if you see something, say something. But that's why a lot of people just don't. So, let's shift gears a moment. We've talked about how we can more effectively use personnel. Let's talk a little bit about why you should effectively use them. Typically speaking, personnel and vehicles tend to be the most expensive parts of any police department's line item budget. And some departments, based on, again, the best statistical data we can find, between 65 and 75% of a department's budget is personnel. And so if we use personnel and vehicles effectively, including take-home vehicles, we can actually increase our deployment without spending a lot of money. Now, before we completely shift our focus, let me talk a little bit more about vehicles before we move on. vehicles are oftentimes, or let me digress a little bit. Gone are the days where police officers had to provide their own cars. Yes, that did happen. And it was not unusual in the 40s and 50s. And even if you were to look at the, even if you were to head over to the Sierra Vista Police Department and you went to their lobby, which has a pretty good historical display case in the lobby, you'll find out that in the 40s, 50s, and up until the 1960s, police officers had to provide their own vehicle. Seldom did you see a department having to or providing a vehicle, but it happens now. Now it's not unusual. Now it's even less unusual for a chief to have an assigned vehicle. What you're starting to see more of, you're starting to see more assigned vehicles and more take-home vehicles. Take-home vehicle plans are especially popular in the Southeast and the Southwest. The idea, of course, is twofold. Number one, in those particular areas, we don't have a problem with rust like we do in the Northeast, in the North. Secondly, it fosters accountability. If an officer is assigned a vehicle, and even more so when he takes it home, experience is showing that officers tend to take better care of their vehicles. Wow, what a concept, huh? And so vehicles last longer. If you're wondering how long these vehicles last, stop by the Sierra Vista campus, and I'll be happy to show you, or rather stop by Salida in Douglas, and I will show you a number of police cars that were formerly assigned and take-home vehicles. And these vehicles, even though they're well over 10 years old, there's still plenty of life in them because they were better. They were taken care of better. And so this is something that other departments may want to emulate, but it also depends on climate. I can't see this working very well in Michigan where I was from, because typically the salt eats the vehicle before the engine wears out. So you end up with body damage long before anything else happens. So we've talked about alternatives or allocations of resources. Now let's talk about how to deal with certain problems. And one of the problems we deal with is, of course, dealing with people with emotional issues. But before I do, let me digress a little, and we'll talk a little bit about tactical operations. Tactical operations takes the idea of random patrol and just tosses it right out the window. The idea is with aggressive and saturation patrol, you put a large number of officers in one specific area for a relatively short period of time. And the idea is you stop everything that moves. We've done this at a number of departments that I've worked at where we've had problems with property crime and burglary. Once we've established aggressive and saturation patrol and start making arrests, we see that crime problem go away. And the reason for it? Because the crooks know that the chances of getting caught are very high. Now, with that said, a hot button issue among law enforcement these days is crisis intervention. How are we dealing with people with mental issues? And sometimes we don't deal with those people very well at all. And so what often happens is the wrong people get shot or the wrong people get killed. And a number of places are looking at what the Memphis Police Department is doing for psychological crisis intervention and adopting those best practices.
A decades-long decline in hospital beds for the mentally ill has contributed to many Americans with mental illnesses ending up in jails. To address that, the city of Memphis pioneered police training techniques to help people with mental illness avoid getting arrested. One thing the Memphis police are taught is that the mentally ill are actually more likely to be victims of violent crimes than perpetrators. In tonight's signature segment, the news hour's Megan Thompson looks at a policing approach that's become a national model.
Police officer Christopher Ross patrols a precinct on the south side of Memphis, an area with a very high rate of crime. Ross sees a lot of violence, drug use, and prostitution.
783.
But those aren't the only types of calls that Ross responds to.
Mother's involved with her son, and he's diagnosed with ADHD and mood disorder. And she said he's been taking his meds, but right now he's being unruly. So we can go and see what we can do to help.
Ross is part of the Memphis Police Department's Crisis Intervention Team, or CIT. Officers specially trained to handle people with mental illness. Here, Ross finds a teenage boy in crisis. His mom says he's being bullied at school.
See, everybody at this school knows that you're smart, that you got something going for yourself, and what they're trying to do is to stop you from being all that you can be.
Ross is trained to de-escalate situations using mostly verbal techniques to keep both officers and citizens safe and keep people with mental health issues out of jail.
Matter of fact, I'm going to give you my number. So when you're having a problem, call me. Okay? If you're feeling sad, you're feeling depressed, call me. And you can tell me whatever you want to tell me. I don't care what it is.
After 20 minutes, the teen is calm and agrees to go back inside. Memphis started its CIT program 27 years ago after the police shot and killed a man with mental illness who charged at them with a knife. The city formed a task force, including the Memphis Police Department and the National Alliance on Mental Illness. At the time, University of Memphis psychiatry professor Randy DuPont was directing the city's main psychiatric emergency service. He helped develop the CIT program.
In an event that's going to escalate become a crisis, it's going to be this first event, so pretty critical. So what they thought about when they came up with this concept was, why don't we take some of that expertise, let's identify those officers that want to do this, that could be good at it, give them some of the best training we can find, and then let's look and see what kind of differences that makes.
Hey, how you doing? You want to call?
That training starts with changing officers' attitudes and perceptions. DuPont says, people in crisis often act out of fear and may not understand what's happening around them. An untrained officer could interpret such behavior as defiance or non-compliance.
Officers are often trained in the academy to see non-compliance and respond with greater use of force. That's part of their training. But in CIT, what we're trying to say to the officers is, let's analyze the non-compliance. Let's look strategically at it. So we're looking for that different interpretation of behavior.
First of all, we have to talk about having compassion.
Major Vincent Beasley is in charge of the Memphis CIT program. He patrolled the streets as a CIT officer for 8 years.
Are all officers cut out to do this kind of work?
I don't think so. I really think it takes a special person to do that. Not everybody's cut out for that. Because you have to have patience. And you have to really care about people. And you have to understand that it's not the individual themselves. It's something that's going on. It's something, you know, in his brain that's not working properly. It's a chemical imbalance.
CIT is having a measurable impact. Major Beasley says, of the 14,000 911 calls last year that CIT officers responded to, only 19 encounters resulted in injuries to a person with mental illness. And the vast majority ended without a person being detained. Around 4,400 were taken to mental health treatment facilities, and just over 600 were taken to jail.
So we're not taking nearly as many people to penal facilities that are suffering from mental illnesses, because we realize they don't need to be there in most cases.
Those with mental illness who do get arrested wind up here at the Shelby County Jail, where there's a special wing with 46 cells for people with mental illness. Hundreds more inmates on psychiatric medication are housed in the jail's general population, where many are also offered psychiatric treatment and group therapy for things like addiction and anger management.
What else would y'all do when he throws up this, how are you going to help me?
Joining the police department's crisis intervention team is voluntary, and officers and dispatchers must attend 40 hours of training. There are 3 days of intensive role-playing based on real situations officers have faced in the field.
I see that you're very upset, and I want to help you.
Nobody cares about me. And when we out of job, man, it's nothing to be here for.
I want to say from the standpoint, like you said,
the trainees, dressed here in plain clothes, also spent a day meeting people with mental illness.
I'm at a point now where I can go back to independent living. I still must take my medication.
They learn about what it's like to live with their conditions and about their experiences with the police.
They came to my house, sheriff's department came to my house and kicked my door in.
Well, he told me to shut my freaking mouth.
Could you have a paramedic make the scene over here?
Today, there are 274 active CIT officers like Chris Ross on the Memphis force of almost 2,100, or about one of every eight officers. The CIT program is operated within the department's existing budgets. Officers wear these pins to identify themselves. Ross, who's been CIT for 3 years, never answers a call without backup. When he's flagged down by a man who says he's a Vietnam veteran and has bipolar disorder, Ross pulls over to talk. He uses simple strategies, introducing himself and being calm.
I'm Officer Ross. Just call me. You okay? Well, call me Chris, okay?
Ross says a huge part of his job is simply listening and keeping tabs on people he knows might need help.
And talk to me.
Well, explode,
don't explode. You wonder why you got exploded? Because you're talking to me.
Here, he checks up on a man he's gotten to know.
Third eye, you in here?
The man lives in an abandoned motel.
You sleep? Come and holler at me. I just want to talk to you, make sure you're doing all right. I got on CNN. I'm a Power Ranger and a superhero. You really on my side. So you
understand. You always try to get them comfortable and let them know I'm getting help. And whatever they say, you listen to it, you repeat it to them so they'll know that you're listening to them. And eventually you'll establish a relationship and they'll feel more or less like you're there to help them versus trying to lock them up.
If Memphis police determine people might pose a danger to themselves or others, an officer can take them to the Crisis Assessment Center for evaluation and medication. Many of the services here are free. It's inside the Memphis Mental Health Institute, so if they need long-term inpatient care, patients don't have to go far. After they leave, there's also a new outpatient program for continuing psychiatric care. Officials say it's reduced the number of repeat visits to both the Crisis Center and the Institute. Mark Havener has been a patient at the Memphis Mental Health Institute. He has bipolar disorder and began having psychotic episodes 17 years ago, locking himself in a closet for hours at a time and attempting to kill himself.
Do you have any idea how many times you've tried to end your life?
Lost count at about 25.
25.
And I lost count of my hospitalizations I got tired of counting at 25.
During one psychotic episode in 2002, Havener started to strangle his wife.
I grabbed her by the throat, and I got up and I shoved her up against the inside of the front door of the house.
After he let her go, she called 911, and CIT officers responded.
By this time, I'm pretty much nonverbal. I can't express what's going on because it's a hurricane inside of me. Elsewhere. They don't even handcuff me because they see what kind of condition I'm in. Treating me as a human being in crisis and not a potential perpetrator.
Havener was hospitalized and never faced criminal charges. He got treatment, and today he is stable, has reconciled with his wife, and works as a counselor to others with mental illness. He's also become an advocate, sharing his story with the CIT trainees.
And that officer crouched down my eyelids. He looked me in the eye. He recognized me as a person.
The strategies developed in Memphis are now called the Memphis Model and have been adopted by almost 3,000 of the nation's 18,000 law enforcement agencies. Studies have shown that CIT-trained officers are less likely to arrest people with mental illness than non-trained officers. For Chris Ross, that's one of the things he likes most about this job, the potential to help people, rather than put them in jail.
That's why I work, that's why I do it, to make a difference. Because if we get to the point where we're making a difference, we won't have to lock so many people up.
And you're probably wondering, why isn't this incorporated in basic police training? Now, what I was saying just before that last video cut out was, if the Memphis plan was so successful, why don't they roll this out patrol-wide? Well, they did. One of the things that agencies, especially agencies in the South and Southwest, are looking at is somehow bringing this same form of training, although not a 40-hour module, but rather something smaller in basic training. And that is one of the things that is part of the Arizona Post curriculum. So if you were to attend the Southeast Arizona Law Enforcement Training Academy, starting, of course, with Class 19-1, insert shameless plug here, you will receive training, or rather, the police officer will receive a base level training of how to deal with people in crisis. Now, with that said, let's shift our attention to some other alternative means of conducting patrol. There are some cities in, for example, the East that does this a lot. There are cities in New York that utilize decoy vehicles. And these are vehicles that are fully marked police cars, but not occupied. The idea is that it creates a certain omnipresence. It gives offenders the impression that the police are there or at least nearby, and it therefore prevents crimes from happening. Another is the use of alternative vehicles. One of the most popular of alternative vehicles is, of course, the bicycle. And this is something that I've had a certain amount of experience in because I, too, was a bike patrol officer in the Detroit area for a number of years. So with that, let's see how bike patrol is done in San Antonio. And it looks like I can't reach that video from here. So apparently it doesn't embed very well. So with that, we'll just simply state that bike patrol is utilized and gets results when traditional deployments don't work so well. So with that, let's look at some other means of deployment. Video cameras are not exactly a issue that everybody's comfortable with. Many times communities are uncomfortable with the idea of a traffic camera being able to, without human intervention, cite somebody for a traffic infraction. We saw traffic cameras be used for the most part in red light enforcement in Florida when I was living there. And a lot of people were upset with that, mostly because the people that were upset were often the ones committing the infraction. And right now it's a political hot potato. In Arizona, we used to have red light enforcement. We don't anymore. Because through the results of certain political factions, the Supreme Court had ruled on the idea of red light enforcement and found that it violates the Confrontation Clause. So this is why we don't have red light enforcement in Arizona. Now, with that said, one of the self-initiated enforcement activities that patrol officers engage in is traffic. And so distracted driving is, of course, a hot-button issue. And this takes on a number of forms, such as texting, talking on cell phones without the use of a hands-free device. And it's becoming a rather serious safety issue. Now, in Arizona, there is no statewide statute that says you can't use a hands-free device. However, in certain communities, it is, for example, Oral Valley near Tucson, it is an infraction to not use a hands-free device. If you were driving on Fort Huachuca, it is also a violation of their statutes to drive on the fort without the use of a hands-free device. And the idea is to keep people from getting off their phones and paying attention to what they're doing. Other efforts, of course, are, of course, drunk driving checkpoints. This is largely through the use of, or rather through the actions of, two special interest groups, Mothers Against Drunk Driving or MAD, and Students Against Drunk Driving or SAD. And this has resulted in a number of things such as saturation patrols and, when the law is permitted, DWI checkpoints. And this is something that patrol may be involved in either as part of their regular duties or as part of a grant-funded overtime activity. But one of the problems we're starting to see now with the legalization of marijuana is we're starting to see more people under the influence of marijuana driving and getting involved in collisions because they're under the influence of marijuana. Personally, I think this is going to be a problem that's going to get worse and will probably not get any better. And as a result, we're probably going to end up having to train more and more drug recognition experts to deal with this problem. So this is something that we're going to see more and more. Aggressive driving is another problem, especially in built-up areas. Toronto, for example, has a huge problem with aggressive driving. This can take in a number of things, such as retaliation for a perceived driving offense, road rage, and motorcycles swarming against other people and causing collisions, forcing them off the road. As a result, we end up with communities that are considering the use of unmarked traffic cars. And this is no exception. The idea behind the unmarked traffic enforcement is if you don't see them, you can't find them until it's too late.
The Arizona Department of Public Safety rolled out Operation No Need for Speed a couple weeks ago to help slow down speeders on the highways. Reporter Nicole Gutierrez spent the morning with DPS Trooper in an unmarked vehicle for a closer look.
Drivers across the valley are used to seeing highway patrol vehicles on the highway and tend to slow down. But with Operation No Need for Speed, troopers will be an unmarked vehicle trying to catch speeders.
But people are late, people are, you know, rushing to get places, and they make that decision at speed.
I was just getting around.
That's why we have these unmarked cars out here to kind of catch them and hopefully slow them down. So you're going to get a ticket for the speed, okay? You need to slow down. Okay, that's 20 miles an hour over the speed limit.
According to Trooper Schmidt, driving an unmarked vehicle helps pace speeders.
It would be tough for me to pace somebody in a marked car just driving down the road like this. You don't usually have somebody that just passes you. A lot of people, they don't even realize that what's going on behind them. They pay attention to everything that's going on in front of them. She gets close, goes into the HOV lane to pass them. Hello, Trooper Schmidt with Highway Patrol in Colonia, 87 miles an hour.
The No Need for Speed crackdown is a zero-tolerance campaign, but Schmidt says that troopers aren't on the highway just to cite drivers.
We can go a day with no tickets, and we can go a day with a lot of tickets. We can go a day with warnings, some of each. There is no requirement as far as quotas.
Schmidt says that patrolling the highway is about maintaining safety.
I would say speed is definitely a factor into how gruesome the accidents can be. I don't want to see a kid get hurt. I don't think anybody wants to see a kid get hurt. And those are just not scenes that you want to go to. And the scenes you don't want to drive by and see.
Although DPS uses unmarked cars to catch speeders, Trooper Schmidt says that you can be the extra eyes on the road. You can call the Arizona Department of Public Safety if you see any unusual or aggressive driving on the freeways. In Phoenix, Nicole Gutierrez, Hawkeye News.
And this sort of enforcement is permissible only in those states that allow officers to do that as part of their motor vehicle code. In Michigan, this is unmarked traffic enforcement is not permitted. In that state, the motor vehicle code states that police officers can only perform traffic stops when they're in a appropriately marked vehicle. And so what a number of agencies have done, and the courts have affirmed the practice, is to utilize cars that have marking on the curbside only. So let's talk about what often happens when you're enforcing traffic. You oftentimes end up in a pursuit. And pursuits are a high liability issue. There's so much of a high liability issue that a great deal of time, both in the academy and during continuing education, is spent discussing driving techniques. So with that, one of the things that's been discovered is some pursuit alternatives. So what to do when you don't want to pursue?
For Michigan Police Departments, traffic stops are becoming anything but routine. They're becoming matters of life or death. Consider this chase in Livingston County. From the moment the suspects decide to floor it, no one is safe. Not the trooper trying to keep up with the fleeing car, not the other drivers who are in harm's way, not even the suspects themselves. In this case, they were run off the road before anyone else got hurt.
It's bad for police, it's bad for the person that's being chased, and of course it's bad for the citizens that are out just conducting their normal business, living their daily lives. It's dangerous for everybody.
And sometimes deadly. In Lincoln Park Monday night, a car Wyandotte police were pursuing flipped over several times, crashed into a nearby restaurant, and exploded. One person inside the car was killed. Luckily, no bystanders were hurt, but innocent lives have been lost when police are forced to pursue. 27-year-old Nicole Cutting was killed by a suspect on the run in Brownstown Township back in August. Police say they broke off the chase and the culprits are to blame for Cutting's death. But scrutiny over deadly police-involved chases can erode the public's trust in law enforcement.
It takes a toll. It takes a toll on law enforcement. It takes a toll on the public image of that law enforcement agency.
So the Lucas County Sheriff's Department in Ohio is turning to technology. It's called Star Chase. A James Bond-looking device mounted on the front of the cruiser uses a laser targeting system to shoot out a GPS dart that sits the fleeing vehicles. Once they're tagged, police can track suspects while staying out of sight.
When we tag somebody with this, they stop running.
With the help of the department, we went on the run to put Star Chase to the test. The dart deploys with the press of a key fob. The officer gives us a 2-mile head start before giving chase. Inside the cruiser, our every turn is monitored. The cruiser's top speed, 26 miles per hour. Thinking we've left the officer behind, we pull into the parking lot of an apartment complex. We didn't see the cruiser coming until it was too late.
Stationary suspect vehicle on Sherman Street at the dead end.
We were a couple miles behind you. We just started making up time. And then once I could see you, I just stayed like a turn behind you and out of sight.
Star Chase isn't cheap. Each unit costs $5,000, not including the cost of replacing darts that have been deployed. And the technology isn't perfect. Darts could miss their targets and may not stick in really wet or snowy conditions. The disadvantages may outweigh the benefits for many departments. Still, increasingly, police-involved chases are putting more lives in danger, perhaps leaving local and state governments with a choice. Pay the price for potentially life-saving technology now, or risk the ultimate price later.
So any technology that we can use, anything that can give us the edge to try to protect the public, which is what our job is, I think is a good thing.
In Lucas County, Ohio, Curtis Jackson, 7 Action News.
And you know we show a lot of chases on the air.
So that's police chases. So let's talk about, in the last few seconds, we're going to talk about various units that provide special services like SWAT and K-9. These units are utilized in very specific circumstances when patrol is unable to handle it. And so these people are very carefully trained, and it's a tremendous asset to law enforcement. Don't forget the reading assignment, and we'll see you on Thursday.